Well, first of all, a great thanks to Mr. Suresh and to all the local organizing team, for the opportunity to participate here in what is going to be a very important meeting. This is sort of a homecoming for me. Kolkata firte shob shomoy amar khub bhalo lage. I was here for a year. I stayed down near Gurjahat and was down there yesterday. It was pretty fun. Okay. Well, as was said, I'm really speaking to you firstly as an autism family member, and secondly as an autism scientist, because the family member thing came first by a long shot. That's me on the right. So if you take one thing away from this talk, that is this one imperative. Listen. Very much too often, we scientists and even some autism professionals, we don't stop to listen to what people with autism are saying to us, often saying to us non-verbally, and to what we can get sort of secondhand from their families, from the people who live with them, who know them best. When I was in graduate school in California, the neuroscience graduate program was right next door to the clinical teaching facility. And so every September, I would see a new class of medical students filing in through one door of the medical school office. And they would emerge through the other door, each of them with a white coat, a stethoscope, and an attitude. It's very, very easy in medical and in professional education in general to think that, I've got all the answers now. I've got the credentials. I've learned from the experts. Hey, you don't know anything. The first step is to admit that you really don't know anything until you listen to people with autism and their families. Well, this was the state-of-the-art treatment in 1965. This is a picture that appeared in Life magazine, and it was talking about this wonderful treatment for autism, applied behavior analysis. This is a picture of the therapy going on at Ivor Lovaas' clinic at UCLA. Now, I probably don't have to tell you what's wrong with this picture. Of course, like just about any therapy, ABA can be conducted in a client-centered way, or it can be conducted in a therapist-centered way. And it is very clear from this slide that, in this instance, the therapist has control of the agenda, and the child in front of him does not agree with that agenda. So let me ask you, here's a child with autism, and please just shout it out. What is this child interested in? Yeah, absolutely. I heard it. The string. Absolutely. Well, you know, if you're coming from a neurotypical perspective, the string might be kind of an odd thing to be interested in, right? Yeah, here it is. It's evidently some kind of holiday. The child is surrounded by toys. And you can imagine the people behind the camera, you know, parents, family, people who want the best for their child with autism. But what are they thinking, especially probably shortly after diagnosis or maybe even before diagnosis? They're thinking, well, why isn't he playing with his toys? Why isn't he looking at the camera? Why isn't he smiling? Why isn't he looking at us? Why isn't he? Why isn't he? Why isn't he? And all of these sort of normalist preoccupations take attention away from what he is doing. Because if you look closely, he's not just staring at that string passively, he's manipulating it. And he has discovered, all on his own, and without any specific instruction, that there is a parametric relationship between the angle of his wrist and the deflection of the string. He can twist it this way, he can twist it this way, and even better than that, it's repeatable. It's predictable. Now, this is a teachable moment, right? A parent could really get into this. But the tragedy of autism so often is that these teachable moments are missed because of what we are preoccupied with. Now, if we ditch that preoccupation, and if we make an effort to meet halfway, to get involved with what the person with autism wants to be involved with, then that can be the basis for building real social interaction and real empathy. So it cuts both ways, is my point. Well, what happens when we don't listen? What happens when professionals do not listen to people with autism and their families? Well, a whole litany of ills. And it begins way back at the beginning of autism, not quite the beginning, because Connor had it mostly right, but Bruno Bettelheim's famous or infamous book, The Empty Fortress, promoted the idea of refrigerator mothers. And of course, psychiatrists then took up that dogma to the effect that half a century ago, my mother was told by some guy in a white coat, "Mrs. Belmonte, don't you feel guilty?" Well, so we haven't been doing so well historically. In France, even into the 1990s, there were certain places in France where autism was, quote unquote, treated exclusively by psychoanalytic methods. Now, the reason for this is that anything that was that smacked of biological psychology was associated historically with the Vichy regime. And because of that prejudice, it was thought that psychoanalysis was the only way to treat autism. Of course, this led to a huge waste. More recently, and even still to some extent continuing to the present day, there is this serious preoccupation among scientists of autism as a disorder of social cognition. Now, does autism affect social cognition? You bet. Absolutely. Social cognition is the most visible, and social communication are the most visible symptoms of autism. But those don't exclude all the other stuff that families were telling us about for decades. What is that other stuff? Well, the biggest complaint, my child just won't sleep. You know, I can't get any sleep because he's up all the time. He sort of cycles around the clock. That was entirely discounted, by and large, until one day Thomas Bergeron at l'Institut Pasteur discovered that ASMT, a gene involved in melatonin synthesis that induces sleep, is also associated with autism. All of a sudden, there was a gene for it. So all of a sudden, it was real. And parents had been saying this for like decades. Same deal, autism and gastrointestinal symptoms. Pat Levitt discovered the MET gene is pleiotropically associated both with autism and with digestive processes. All of a sudden, this was a real thing. Parents had been talking about it for decades. And you can go on and on and on. Immune symptoms, allergies, sensory issues, motor problems, and so forth. Well, what else happens when we don't listen to parents and families and people with autism? They learn that if we're not going to listen to them, they're not going to listen to us because they can't get anything out of us. And therefore, we don't get an opportunity or we don't get credibility when we rightly try to shut down bogus therapies. Auditory training, quote-unquote stem cell therapy, and I put that in quotes because the stuff that's marketed as stem cell therapy actually doesn't really involve much of stem cells or of therapy. I distinguish that from the talk about stem cells earlier today. Chelation, the anti-vaccination movement. You know, you can go on and on and on. The flip side of that is that useful therapies that have been kind of discovered informally and often rediscovered by families are ignored. Music therapy had been a big thing amongst autism families, it was and really still is understudied. And props to Megha Sharda, who's in the audience and who's whom you've heard talking up here, for actually running a really nice brain connectivity study of the effect of music therapy on speech perception. Lego therapy, therapies that involve role-taking, therapies that involve keyboards and letterboards. Again, you could go on and on and on. This is not an exhaustive list. My favorite criticism among scientists, and I've heard this coming from scientists making snarky comments in meetings, is, he or she isn't even looking at it. In type communication therapy, he isn't even looking at the keyboard. This is so bogus. Well, about that, we ran a study several years ago now showing that basically the more one gazes directly at a stimulus or at a communication partner, the worse one does if one is autistic. Because you can't do more than one thing at the same time. You can either gaze at the stimulus and perceive it, or you can think about how to respond to it, but you can't do both at the same time. That finding has now been replicated by Doherty Sneddon et al. Actually, it was replicated shortly thereafter. So the point of all this is that as scientists, we have ideologies, we have prejudices, and we need to recognize that we have that. We don't live in a world where science is absolute. Science is a human and prejudicial endeavor. I was associated many years ago with a foundation called Cure Autism Now, which was since absorbed into Autism Speaks. And of course, lately there's been a lot of public rhetoric about what exactly that that means. What it means, and has always meant to me, is finding a way of giving people with autism the communicative abilities to let out their thoughts, to share their unique insights with the rest of the social world. And it has never been, and will never be, about deleting those insights. I skipped, actually, in the previous slide, a great sort of pithy description of autism. This is from Vasudha Prakash, who runs the VXL Center in Chennai. And she talked about people with autism having, quote, thoughts housed in bodies and minds that may be fragmented. There actually is a lot that's known here in India about the relationship between bodies and minds, movement and cognition, and how that relates to autism, and that's something I'll get to in a little bit. Okay, well, here in South Asia, we're embedded in collectivist cultures, and that brings to autism very much a double-edged sword. On the one hand, in a collectivist culture, if one is a member of the in-group, a member of the family, a member of the community, whatever the in-group is, there is great capacity for support and for scaffolding. And in my observation, actually, that makes a significant effect, for example, in men with mild Asperger syndrome here in South Asia, who have a much better time of it, I think, than they would have in England. But the flip side of that is a capacity for ruthless ostracism of the out-group. And I think in order to, sorry. Yes? Okay. I think in order to sort of make the demarcation between those, one has to consider, who really is not in my in-group? What human being is not part of my community, and whose soul is not actually a divine soul? If everybody is a member of the in-group, if all people, including all people with autism, deserve our support, then we have so much capacity here in South Asia to lend that support. One of the issues that we face is that we can be really good here in India about talking about what's the right thing. But then comes the translation to actually doing it. So often, you can go into the cinema, and I don't know if y'all know this film, it's kind of old now, but any Mani Ratnam fans out there? Yeah, okay. How many people cried when Anjali finally said Amma? Yeah. But the thing is, you go to a film, and you can understand intellectually, you know, what's the right thing to do. And then so often, you know, we'll come out of the cinema and we'll walk past somebody who needs our help, and we won't connect that sort of theory to practice. So I urge you all, you know, when you come out of this meeting, let this meeting have an impact. It's all great for us to feel virtuous about ourselves here in this hall. You know, we know and we can say what's the right thing to do, but then we have to go out and do it. It really has to affect practice. We have the issue here in South Asia that very often children are expected to adapt to the school, to adapt to the institution, rather than the institution adapting to them. So education tends to be school-centered rather than child-centered. When it's centered on the institution and not the child, education has a hard time being inclusive. And once, when I was living here in Kolkata, I was asked to go and have a look at an autistic student at a school. The school was up on BT Road. So for those of you who are from here, obviously, BT Road is probably like right on the road, is probably the worst place to have a school, because there's all this traffic noise, horning, so on and so forth. Add to that, there's a tree right outside the school room, and sunlight is shining down through the tree, and it's making these dappled patterns. And the school was like, the classroom was like 40 or 50 people, all loud. And the problem was that this child, whom I had been asked to have an informal look at, he had been disrupting class by compulsively reciting out loud some things that he needed to say to calm himself down amid all these stimuli. So I went, and then they said, well, you know, we've told him he can't do this, and his behavior has just got worse. So I'm like, well, how has it got worse? And they said, well, now he's, you know, he's jumping up at his desk, and he's running outside the school building. I said, what, is he running into the road? What is he doing? No, he's just standing at the door. Okay, well, what does he do when he stands at the door? Well, he just recites these compulsive things that he says, you know. And I said, okay, do you see that he's trying to work with you? You told him he couldn't say those things inside the school. Duh. So he goes outside the school to say them. The point is, when we work with children, when we work with anybody with autism or without, and when we center our interventions around them, we can achieve a much, much, much better outcome and much happier people. So, with that as background, I'm going to tell you about two design projects that we've done that have, to various degrees, involved people at various positions on the autism spectrum. So I'm going to start with a set of computer games that are not actually therapeutic. They're just used to measure autistic cognitive abilities. And then I'm going to end with some therapeutic software, which is what we're working on now. Okay. So the first one is this computer game series called Astropolis. This is assessing autistic cognition. And so that I don't miss them out, let me tell you, this isn't just me. It was a whole team of programmers who are the row of people up at the top. You can kind of tell they're programmers, can't you? And my designer, August Zinser, and the rest of my lab. Well, focused attention to detail. Is it a virtue or is it a vice? Well, it depends on context, doesn't it? When we first put our project on the web, I was kind of counting down the days until we would get email from Google, because Google knows everything, and as soon as we went on the web, I was sure they were going to discover us. Well, it took about a month for the email to come, and when it came from an organization within Google called Project Spectrum. And this is an organization that was kind of grassroots at first, because parents of people with autism who were designers discovered that Google's SketchUp software, which is software for creating virtual objects on a computer, virtual three-dimensional objects and environments, was actually really, really appealing to their autistic children and was teaching them a lot. So we ended up working with Google Project Spectrum to design a lot of the artwork for the games. So I'll just show you briefly some stills from the games. This is a game called Maritime Defender. And what this is about is the ability to make a go, no-go decision. Right? Example of that in real life is you come to a traffic light. Is it red or green? If it goes green, then you've got to go. If it's red, you stop. This game, there's either a friendly or an enemy spaceship emerging from a wormhole. And of course, if it's an enemy, you have to shoot it quickly before it shoots you. If it's a friend, you have to avoid shooting it. You actually have to inhibit. And of course, people with autism, when they have to make that speedy decision about whether to inhibit an action based on context, that can take them a while. And it can be, they can commit errors of commission, you know, pulling the trigger to shoot when they really shouldn't. So we measure that in a game. And one of the measurements that we took is the brain electrical response during the no-go decision, during the decision to inhibit an action. What we found is that the people with autism in red had an extremely high brain electrical response, as if they were working extra hard to make this inhibitory decision. The people without autism, the blue trace, and these are 10 to 15-year-old children, I should say, they didn't have to work as hard to inhibit. And interestingly, we also looked at siblings of people with autism who don't themselves have autism. Siblings of people with autism, I guess you could say, is my special interest. So they're in green, and they're smack dab in the middle. The nifty thing was that the responses, if you looked at the individuals, of all of these people kind of overlapped. There was no neat distinction between the autistic responses and the sibling responses and the non-autistic responses. And one's level of social skills was predicted by the amplitude of this brain response. So, we proved with that we could use a video game to actually say something interesting about autism. Another game is called Stellar Prospector. It's about mining asteroids for space ore. And it's about reacting to expected and unexpected targets and also ignoring distracting stimuli, stimuli that are not relevant to the task. In that, we found that non-autistic people respond much, much more strongly to the task-relevant stimulus than they do to the irrelevant stimulus, irrelevant responses in red. The people with autism responded equally to the two, and when it came to the case of the task-irrelevant stimulus, the distracting stimulus, it was as though they just couldn't let go of it. They kept at it and kept at it and kept at it, and this brain response persisted for seconds. And then when we looked at the siblings, something really interesting happened. Their brains very much differentiated the two stimuli, but to a lesser degree. But the siblings, too, got stuck on the irrelevant stimulus. They just couldn't let go of it. We designed another game. This one was about social skills, about knowing what other people know and don't know and predicting what they will do, so-called theory of mind. And in brief, it was about captains of spaceships flying around and depositing treasure boxes, and then they have to go where they think that the treasure is being deposited to steal it, so on and so forth. We used this one looking at typical individuals, non-autistic individuals, and we asked, what does this show us about level of autistic traits in the general population? How good are people, even without autism, at looking at what other people know and don't know? And we found that performance in this game, how quickly you make decisions in this game, correlates very, very nicely with the efficiency of brain networks in something called the right temporoparietal junction. I'll skip all the neuroscience behind that, but again, this is a result that came just out of a video game. So we were quite pleased with the results of all these games, and we also learned something about how to design and how not to design experiments with and for people with autism. Number one, we learned that cognitively, people with and without autism, yeah, there are differences, but they're mostly differences of degree. They're more alike than different. Okay. Number two, we learned that game design is not the same as game programming, and you can't use programmers as designers. And number three, we learned that designers really have to know their audience. Listening to experts on autism doesn't cut it. You have to actually get them into a classroom, into a family, and have them observe autistic behavior.
Let's fix it here.
Whoops. Hey. This wasn't, I think that slide is out of order. But we can come back to it. Okay. In my last 5 minutes, I want to present the second task that we did. This is in collaboration with the ComDeal Trust in Bangalore. And in brief, at ComDeal, we identified in a class of 31 people, so we took everybody in the entering class that year, and we measured gross and fine motor skills, oromotor skills, receptive language and expressive language, and we found that in about a third of the people in that class, 11 of them, there was this curious pattern where motor skills in general were slightly impaired, oral motor skills were severely impaired. These are the pink traces. You can see that dip in the oral motor. And there was a corresponding advantage in receptive language over expressive language. In other words, they could understand a lot more than they could actually speak. Well, it doesn't take a brainiac to figure out that if their oral motor skills, their ability to move their mouths and their vocal tracts is impaired, and that correlates with difficulty in speaking, then probably the reason that they have trouble speaking is a motor issue. And I'm not saying that all people with autism and minimal speech are like this, but I am saying that in our sample, about a third of them fit this profile. So we developed an intervention aimed to target that, and we co-designed that with people with autism. And there's an issue there because, you know, how do you co-design a piece of software with people who can't talk back to you and give you verbal feedback? One of the things we did is start with what we knew from theory and practice. So we knew we wanted to capitalize on autistic cognitive strengths, so we based it as a kind of jigsaw puzzle, focusing on putting together local features. We knew that we wanted to accommodate the difficulty that people with autism have integrating visual feedback with an ongoing movement. So often, you know, they reach towards something, and it's kind of like playing pin the tail on the donkey, because they're not using this visual feedback, and in fact, it's so distracting, sometimes they just look away. And they'll go, and they'll hit close, but not on. The one change that we made that really made a whole lot of difference was instead of registering the initial point of contact with the touchscreen, we registered the point of departure. So they have time to meet the surface of the touchscreen, then kind of wiggle around, successively approximate where they want to be, and then when they leave the screen, they're at the right place. Errorless learning. Stimuli that capture and recapture and refocus attention on the game, and a lot of data logging. So the feedback that we collected from these non-speaking people with autism came from both their playing prototype versions, but also before we even had it coded up, the team went down there and did what's called in game design, a Wizard of Oz prototype, where they would be the secret agent behind a board with a magnet moving a stimulus along the board as the person with autism interacted with it from the other side. In addition to that direct feedback from people with autism, we took indirect feedback from therapists. And in brief, the feedback that we got The most crucial point is that caregiver direction and modeling are very, very important to have. The software actually has a negative effect on autistic motor skills if it is not supervised by a caregiver in an errorless learning and modeling format. So we have three levels: point, type, and speak. In the first level, the person with autism just learns how to interact motorically with the touchscreen. In the second level, we kind of throw a curveball at them by having them press a key that matches the letter with which a puzzle piece is labeled to cause that puzzle piece to snap into place. So the aim here is to teach them that an object can be represented as a sequence of keystrokes. And we have a third level for the people who are capable of some vocal output where they can speak syllables to cause pieces to pop into place. So I'll just show you a slight video and then I'll end.
Let's do cake first. Let's type.
So you can see the therapist modeling the proper response. And then as this goes on, you'll see that the client takes over.
Yes, you want to try another one? Let's try. Which one? Balloon. Waiting. Now type B. Where's B?
You can see him perseverating on that iconic motor reference. He wants to move the puzzle pieces into place directly rather than tapping the key.
L.
And she's redirecting him.
You have to finish typing. L. O. O. Good. O. Where's O? Where's O? Good. N. Yippee! Balloon! Now let's try next one.
Okay. I'll leave that there in the interest of time. Just briefly, we've shown that the practice with the software improves autistic motor capabilities, and we're working right now on a randomized controlled trial looking at whether it actually improves communicative abilities. This is funded by the National Health Service in the UK. I'll be happy to talk afterwards individually about what we want to do with this in the future because it was developed in India and it would be great if it could come home to India. Thank you very much and I'll stop there.